Well, hey, what's going on, guys? Gonna do a little fishing. Hope to catch some fish, enjoy my time out here. But it makes me think of a verse in the Bible where Jesus tells his early followers, hey, come and follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. That's an interesting verse. Do you think that still applies to us today? Well, let's talk about it in our lesson. You guys ready? Let's go. Hey guys, this week we're talking about the gospel of Jesus. The word gospel means good news. The gospel of Jesus is the good news that God saves all people from their sin, making them new and making them right with Him. It's through the gospel of Jesus that God changes people and has His Spirit come live in their hearts. Jesus describes this as being born again. Listen to His words in John 3:3. He says, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they're born again. Wait, people can't even see God's kingdom and who He really is unless they become born again? Professor Wendell, a little help?
Correct, Kenneth, students. From birth, people have eyes to see the physical things in this world, but actually blind to the spiritual world, which is where the kingdom of God is. God has started processing us where He opens our spiritual eyes so we can see how He sees us and how He sees this world. Quite impressive.
Thanks, Professor Wendell. Without being born again, the people of this world remain lost with blinded eyes. People need to know that only God can give them a clean slate and they can literally start life new again as if they've been reborn.
There's this beautiful poem. It's in the book of Isaiah.
The city of Jerusalem has just been destroyed by Babylon, a great kingdom in the north. And all of these Jewish people, they've been sent away into exile, but a few remained in the city. And they're left wondering, what just happened? Has our God abandoned us?
Right, because Jerusalem was supposed to be the city where God would reign over the world to bring peace and blessing to everyone.
Now, Isaiah had been saying that Jerusalem's destruction was a mess of Israel's own making. They had turned away from their God, become corrupt, and so their city and their temple were destroyed.
Yeah, everything seems lost.
But the poem goes on. There's a watchman on the city walls, and far out on the hills we see a messenger, and he's running towards the city. He's running and he's shouting, "Good news!" And Isaiah says, "How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news."
Beautiful feet?
Yes. The feet are beautiful because they're carrying a beautiful message.
What's the message?
That despite Jerusalem's destruction, Israel's God still reigns as king, and that God Himself is going to one day return to this city, take up His throne, and bring peace.
And the watchmen sing for joy because of the good news that their God still reigns.
Now, in the New Testament, we find this same phrase, the good news. It's the Greek word euangelion, and it's also sometimes translated with the word gospel.
Yeah, so when Christians say, "Do you believe the gospel?" they mean, "Do you believe the news?"
But not just any news. In the Bible, this phrase is always about the announcement of the reign of a new king. And in the New Testament, the Gospels use this phrase to summarize all of Jesus' teachings. They say that He went about proclaiming the good news of God's kingdom.
So Jesus saw Himself as the messenger, bringing the news that God reigns.
Yes, but the way that He described God's reign, it surprised everybody. I mean, think, a powerful, successful kingdom. It needs to be strong, able to impose its will, able to defeat its enemies. But Jesus said the greatest person in God's kingdom was the weakest, the one who loves and who serves the poor. And He said that you live under God's reign when you respond to evil by loving your enemies and forgiving them and seeking peace. This is an upside-down kingdom.
Now, Jesus also said that this kingdom was arriving with Him.
Yeah, so for example, there's this really interesting story where there's a high-ranking Roman officer, and he comes to Jesus begging Him to heal his servant. And he even calls Jesus his Lord, acknowledging that Jesus is his authority. Jesus praises this man for recognizing what no one else yet had, that not only was Jesus announcing God's kingdom, he was the king.
And so the word gets out that this Jewish man from Galilee is talking and acting like he's the king of Israel. He's appointing 12 disciples, which are an image of Israel's 12 tribes. He's healing people, forgiving people their sins.
And all of this so threatened Israel's leaders that they finally decide to have him killed. And Jesus let them.
Yeah, which is a weird thing to do if you're trying to become king.
That's right. But for Jesus, this is what had to happen. Jesus saw the sin and the devastation of his people Israel as just one small part of the entire human condition. How all humanity has rebelled against God, resulting in the tragedy and devastation of our whole world. So how is God going to bring his reign over such a world? Jesus believed it would be through an act of sacrificial love for his enemies. This is why in the Gospels, Jesus' crucifixion is depicted as his enthronement as the king of the Jews.
Yeah, he receives a crown. He also receives a robe.
He's exalted up, not onto a throne, but onto the cross.
How beautiful are the feet that bring good news.
And the good news now is that Jesus has defeated death, and that he reigns as king, that he's dealt with our sin and corruption himself, and that he's conquered it with his life and with his love.
And then Jesus sends his followers to go out and keep announcing this good news of the upside-down kingdom.
And to invite everyone to give their allegiance to him, the king who defeated death with his love.
So it's clear that the good news about Jesus is the most important news the world could ever hear. But what can I, as a receiver of this good news, do to help the lost people of this world? Share this good news about Jesus. And that's this week's bottom line. I can share the good news about Jesus. Say that with me. I can share the good news about Jesus. How exciting that God would allow us as receivers of the good news to then be the ones to go and share the good news with others. Listen to Romans 10:15. It tells us how beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news. Wow, this means it's a beautiful sight to have someone deliver this good news instead of bad, harmful, or even condemning news. Announcing this good news is the only way for real change to happen in this world. So if you've received it, will you share it? Now is the time. Guys, Jesus says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever would believe in him will not perish, but have everlasting life." If you haven't been born again, now's your time. Would you pray with me? God, I thank you so much for sending Jesus for me to forgive my sins and to make me a new person. And right now, for the very first time, I want to receive him as my Lord, as my Savior. I openly say and confess with my mouth today, Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. God, I thank you that the Bible promises that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, and that's me today. And because of that, I am born again by your grace. I thank you for this, God, for your love and for saving me today. I thank you for it in Jesus' name.